Hello everyone, we're going to go ahead and get started. My name is Elena Kidd and I'm a program director with the University of Alabama at Birmingham School of Public Health's Office of Public Health Practice. So I'm very excited to welcome you today to today's webinar, Face Masks, Materials, Fit, and Filtration During the COVID-19 Pandemic, featuring Dr. Jeremy Walker from the University of Alabama at Birmingham. This webinar is made possible by the Alabama Regional Center for Infection Prevention and Control Training and Technical Assistance Center, or ARC-IPC. The ARC-IPC was established to meet the consultation and support service needs surrounding the infection prevention and control throughout the state of Alabama. The center is a collaborative effort of the Alabama Department of Public Health's Infectious Disease and Outbreaks Division and the University of Alabama at Birmingham. The ARC-IPC provides training and technical assistance to infection prevention and control and public health professionals in areas needed to detect, respond to, control, and prevent infectious disease outbreaks. You can learn more about the center, view and listen to past trainings, webinars and podcasts, request training and technical assistance, and view infection prevention and control resources at uab.edu/ARC-IPC. And you can also email arcipc.edu@uab.edu with any questions. And don't forget to sign up for our newsletter to stay up to date about future trainings. You can sign up for our newsletter on our homepage of our website. We'd like to thank our co-sponsor for today's webinar, the Deep South Center for Occupational Health and Safety. You can learn more about the center and upcoming events on their website. We'd also like to let you know about our next upcoming webinar, Epidemiology 101, Fundamental Concepts for Understanding the Pandemic. In this webinar, participants will be given several tools to read critically and think about pandemic-related news, and we'll explore concepts like herd immunity, vaccine efficacy, and the endemic infection, and consider what they mean for COVID-19. This webinar will be presented by the ARC-IPC and co-sponsored by the Region 4 Public Health Training Center and the Deep South Center for Occupational Health and Safety, and it is approved by the Alabama Board of Nursing for one CEU contact hour. It will be held on Thursday, February 24th at 12 p.m. Central Standard Time. Related to this webinar topic, we also wanted to highlight our most recent training video, Masks and Respirators. This video covers different types of masks and face coverings, how they protect against infection from COVID-19, and how to select which type of mask to wear. Many thanks to Dr. Claudio Lungu, Professor of Environmental Health Sciences at the University of Alabama at Birmingham School of Public Health for recording this video. You can access the video by using your phone to scan the QR code on the right-hand side of your screen or through our website. Alabama continuing education credits have been approved for nurses by the Deep South Center for Occupational Health and Safety for this program. In order to receive credit for this training, you must register for the training, watch the entire program, and complete the evaluation following the program. Upon completion of the evaluation, you will be redirected to the Alabama Nursing CEU request form on the ARC-IPC's website, which you will also need to complete. CEUs will be awarded by the Deep South Center for Occupational Health and Safety. You do not have to submit directly to the Alabama Board of Nursing. CE units for this program will expire on February 17, 2023. If you experience any issues, please email arcipc@uab.edu. And finally, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker. Dr. Jeremy Walker is from Huntsville, Alabama, and completed medical training at UAB, including both an internal medicine residency and infectious diseases fellowship. He concentrated in clinical training and caring for infections of immune-compromised hosts, including those with organ transplants and malignancies. Dr. Walker recently joined a faculty as an associate professor with an appointment as an associate healthcare epidemiologist at UAB. Much of his research interest surrounds preventing infections in immune-compromised hosts, and in his free time, he enjoys spending time with his wife and two daughters, ages 1 and 3. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to turn things over to Dr. Walker. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you so much. I'm an assistant professor in infectious diseases and specifically transplant ID. I do not have any relevant financial disclosures, But I include this picture, and this was originally actually a selfie that I took right before going into my first kind of time in the COVID clinic as a provider. And I sent it to my wife, and at the time she ended up printing it out and putting it in the baby book of our toddler as kind of a remembrance of that period of time, which had a lot of uncertainty, also had a lot of more time spent together as a family unit, which has some positives as well. And so I share that to say that's really the two perspectives I'm coming from. On the one hand, you know, I work in transplant ID. I've seen these patients that are immune compromised, some of which have had really severe infections with SARS-CoV-2, have been in the ICU, and I've taken care of them there. At the same time, I've also taking care of them in clinic and had lots of conversations around safe practices and things that they can do to try to mitigate their risk with COVID. On the flip side, in my other life, I'm a parent and have two kids, 1 and 3. And much like anyone who's a caregiver, and I feel so much for caregivers, it seems like this just continues to go on and on. And here we are 2 years into a global pandemic, and you're always faced with a lot of questions that you feel like you don't have the best answer to, regardless, just going through life when you're trying to care for someone else. And I think this pandemic has just presented so many new challenges and things to think about. So my frame is coming primarily from those two viewpoints, how I think about this as a clinician and counseling my patients, and how I think about it as an individual in talking with friends and family who also are young parents as well. So our learning objectives that were kind of published with the webinar are here, but a bit of an outline about how we'll approach this. So we'll start with talking a bit about how masking within U.S. healthcare settings kind of was established prior to COVID. And then we'll get into this conversation of airborne versus droplet, because that was a kind of a point of debate early on. And really, COVID helped us to kind of change our traditional definitions of those things. We'll get into the more practical view for those who are trying to think just personally about how to choose the right mask. I know we have quite a diverse audience here today, and so that will kind of walk through materials, filtration, fit, and function. And then finally, we'll just summarize a few trials that I think are helpful in kind of discussing what we know about the effectiveness of masking, particularly when it comes to decreasing community spread. So a brief history of masking, it starts with the procedural mask. And of course, a much earlier rendition of this was introduced in the 1890s, and really in the surgical OR is where it was initially used. The idea being A, it would protect the surgeons from body fluids, and B, it would also protect the patients from potential surgical infections. And in particular, at that time, it was felt like most infections kind of came from the respiratory tract. So masking was early ascribed to. As you move forward into the early 1920s, this remembers right around the time of the Great Influenza, around that time is when it became obvious that it can also offer protection for healthcare workers for respiratory pathogens. And it began being used for diphtheria, meningococcus, influenza as well. Next comes the respirator. And so really the respirators were initially developed for industry and to try to help protect from inhalation of various substances and people that were out working, things that could be toxic and wanting to filter all those dust and particles. It was really in the 1970s that our more recent N95 was created, and that became prominent in medical settings in the 1990s. And the main reason for that was concerns around drug-resistant tuberculosis. So tuberculosis has been kind of the typical pathogen we think of when it comes to an N95 respirator, but our use of an N95 respirator. So what did we do as far as precautions in the hospital? Where everyone is kind of put under something that's called standard precautions, right? That's just doing the basic things of making sure you're washing your hands before and after the patient encounter, making sure that you're putting on gloves if you're going to be doing something like drawing blood or handling body fluids. And then there are certain transmission-based precautions we use in certain conditions. And one of the main reasons is because concern for infection and preventing infection. So the first is contact precautions. And so that is a gown and glove. Many of you may have seen these if you've had healthcare exposure. Certainly you've seen pictures of them on TV. And in isolation, we generally use those for either multi-drug resistant bacteria or diarrheal illnesses. Clostridium difficile is a common reason that one might be on contact precautions. The next is droplet. And so droplet for the personal protective equipment is generally a surgical mask, which is of course depicted here. And the idea is sometimes depending on the pathogen, depending on the situation, if there's gonna be a lot of aerosolization, you may also use eye covering as well. Source control is encouraged, particularly if the patient is coughing and doing other things. So you would offer a mask if they're able, and certainly if they're traveling from their room to another space. And this is used for respiratory pathogens, again, like influenza is kind of the quintessential example. And then there's airborne precautions. And so this actually, the PPE or personal protective equipment is a fit tested respirator mask or N95. And in addition to that, the patient is actually placed in a negative pressure room. So you have good ventilation that is pulling out and kind of recycling the air on a very strict schedule to make sure that there's not an opportunity for aerosols to collect in that space. Source control is encouraged when the patient particularly is leaving that room to go to a procedure, et cetera. So they would put a, not necessarily a N95, but just a surgical mask on the patient. And this is again used for pathogens like tuberculosis, measles would be another example. Thankfully, we don't see measles, but our many, we have, I haven't seen any cases of measles and thanks to our vaccination rates, but that would be another pathogen where this would be appropriate. So I guess the idea here is that, you know, pathogens in general, especially our viral pathogens, are carried within respiratory secretions. And it's because the respiratory droplets actually protect the virus. So SARS-CoV-2, for example, it doesn't actually survive very well in the environment. It gets dried out very quickly. But when it's encapsulated in respiratory droplets, it can survive for much longer. And so when you're breathing, singing, talking, doing whatever it is that you're doing, you will see, you will be basically having all of these different size particles emitted. And the kind of traditional cutoff was just 5 micrometers. So greater than 5 micrometers was considered a large droplet and smaller than 5 micrometers was considered a small droplet. So you can kind of see that you're releasing both in any given activity. And so the traditional view of droplet precautions was that pathogens that are carried in these larger respiratory secretions or droplets, which by the way, most of these are emitting from the upper airways, they're larger, so from that space, they generally fall towards the ground within 6 feet. And so if you have a provider or someone that's 6 feet away from the patient talking and the person's emitting these viruses, they're going to be falling to the ground before they actually reach, and certainly before they certainly will be lower than kind of the area of concern where they could be coming in contact with mucous membranes, et cetera. Contrast that to the traditional view of airborne. So these are pathogens or were traditionally thought as pathogens that were in small respiratory secretions or aerosols. And these generate generally from the lower airways, like the alveoli, and they can actually remain in the air for several hours. And they're somewhat subject to the kind of wind and different air movement in the room. So if you have a space that's not well ventilated, especially closed, enclosed, then you could certainly see these aerosols kind of concentrating throughout the room over a period of time. And that distance is not going to be as protective. You're still going to walk through and potentially be exposed, particularly in the areas of concern and areas of mucous membranes. So I think COVID kind of brought in some questions around that dichotomous view that we had. If you think about it from a bacterial standpoint, the dichotomy actually works pretty well. So tuberculosis, at least when it infects the lungs, it generally does infect the alveoli. And so generally it is secreted as an aerosol. I mean, it's within the aerosols and the smaller articles that we're, particles that we're emitting. In contrast, something like meningococcus, which can cause pneumonia, is more in the upper airway. So it's more in those larger droplets. And so droplet precautions maybe more apply. The problem with respiratory viruses is their rate of replication is just so much higher. And although they're tropic to certain areas in the lungs, they still can involve the entire organ and respiratory tract. So SARS-CoV-2 influenza, they affect the alveoli and the larger airways, and therefore the virus can shed in particles from all various sizes. And so really, I think what this kind of confrontation prompted was a better understanding of the viral respiratory particle spectrum, which is that, you know, we have larger droplets, we have small droplets, we have sizes in between, and we're emitting a ton of these at any given time. And there is probably more of a gradation or line between what is droplet and what is airborne. And part of it is where the virus is shedding. This picture, I think, looks intentionally a little scary. And the way it is depicted, you almost think the person is coughing or yelling or something, but normal speaking produces thousands of these particles. So I just want to emphasize this is really something that we're exposed to and doing all of the time. And it's very much just a natural part of the way we breathe and respirate. So why did the traditional definition work for influenza? If it was involving, you know, the smaller airways, larger airways, how did it work? And really the thing was that the definition was more based off in general practice, where we saw people that, what was the proximity in which people were infected. So if you look at, in general, looking back at influenza, most of the time, if someone was infected, they had close contact within 6 feet of a person who had influenza. Contrast that to measles, where we knew people could be across the room, even in an adjoining room, and there would be reported positive cases. And so what that is really probably a better picture of is something rather than the droplet size that it's in, is more thinking about the infectious dose. And there's a lot of parameters that affect that. And so the first thing is the exposure concentration. So obviously if you're closer to the source and exposed to more types and sizes of droplets, then you're gonna have a higher infectious dose. So the first thing is just moving, that proximity of moving away is decreasing your infectious dose because then you're being less exposed to some of these larger droplets and even the concentration of the smaller aerosols. The next thing that we know you can do is add ventilation, right? You can open up a window or you can take this meeting outside, and that ventilation is going to, you know, depending on how good it is, can significantly impact the number of viral particles that you see in the air and the number that might come into contact with mucous membranes or concerning spaces. The next thing, which is a bit more challenging and a bit and impossible really to define on an individual basis, is viral shedding. And so that's one of the things that's probably different about various pathogens. And so some viruses are just much better at shedding into these respiratory viruses and thus passing. That's a distinction between like influenza versus measles. It's also probably a distinction between some of our variations or waves of COVID. And so the Omicron variant was particularly good at shedding early in disease before there was symptoms in some patients. And so you would see higher rates of infectivity. The other thing is on an individual basis, some people just shed more. And so there are, you know, and that is really hard to predict and impossible to know, but when they've done studies, there are people who tend to be almost like super spreaders, that they have a lot of viral shedding in their aerosols. And that's kind of the anecdote that you'll hear is you have one person at a party of 15 and 3 days later, 14 people tested positive. And that seems like some sort of super spreader event. Like how could that happen? And you would presume that there would be a high concentration in those aerosols. Contrast that to the person who, that, you know, who lives in the same space in the same home with someone and no one else in that family gets sick. And so I think those two anecdotes in part exist because of other things that are going on, but also because people have a various degree of shedding. And I apologize that my PowerPoints were acting out for a minute there. The final thing, so you have your exposure concentration, and then you also have your factor of time. So obviously the less time that you spend in a space, the less amount of infectious dose you're going to get and the more protected you're going to be. And again, there's a lot of pathogen specific characteristics to consider within this. So this gets into the Swiss cheese model, which is really, of course, anytime you're trying to prevent something, you don't want one barrier, but you want multiple. And so we already showed that just physical distance and ventilation can really change what you're looking at as far as the risk of infection here. But then of course we have all these other things that we do, vaccines, hand hygiene, cough etiquette, limiting time in crowded spaces, testing and testing availability, staying home when sick. All of those things are incredibly important. So we're gonna talk about masking today, which is an important kind of cornerstone in this, but there are a lot of other things that need to be done as well as you're trying to add in layers of protection, particularly when you think about preventing infections in a group of people. So how do you choose the right mask for use? This is kind of the practical portion. You wanna look at materials, filtration, fit, and function. And so these are your kind of basic mask outlined here. You have your cloth mask. you have your surgical mask, and you have your N95. When we talk about materials, we're primarily thinking about the cloth mask group. I'll talk to you a little bit more about the qualification systems for the other medical mask. And so they're actually tested and have a standard with which they hold to, but of course cloth can be all over the place. So what should you look for? Well, the first thing is fiber density. You wanna make sure it's a highly concentrated fiber. It's not got large spaces. It's not something that's easy to see through. The next thing is layers. And ideally really having three layers is kind of the best. And if one of those layers is a filter, that's even better, is the best way to ensure that you have a quality cloth mask. How do you figure that out? You know, one question is just, does it block light? So this example here is clearly not a very good thing to use as a mask. You can see essentially directly through that to these to the lights that are there, and you can see these large gaps in the fiber density. So this would be a bad example of a good material to choose for a cloth mask. The next thing is avoid exhalation valves, and these you can actually see on N95s. And again, initially these were produced for industry. And so if you think about industry, you're trying to protect them from inhaling the things that are being put up from whatever work they're doing, but it might be beneficial for them to be able to exhale easily. And so the exhalation valve just allows you to exhale freely into the space without any filtration. So that's fine for the individual who's wearing that mask, but for the community as a whole, then you're emitting whatever your respirations that you're breathing, all of those particles are just going out into the world without any sort of filtration. So that's why exhalation valves are not recommended in general when we're thinking about, you know, kind of protecting ourselves and those around us. And it's why they're not allowed on in places like airplanes and other things where masks are required. So if you talk about a surgical mask or a N95 mask, you get into this filter and what is filtration and what exactly are they measuring and talking about? And so it's a physical barrier. And so to orient you here, the concept is like, these are the fibers in the filter. And so you would be over here taking a breath in, the air is kind of following in as you're breathing in and going through the filters to try so that you can breathe. And so, you know, these larger droplets are large enough that they may not care too much about the airflow that you're generating. They may be large enough to not get picked up by that. They may just impact here on the various filter fibers. In addition, even if they do kind of try to follow the airflow, they're pretty big, so they may impact the fiber as well and be neutralized. What about the small molecules though, these aerosols that we're talking about? Well, there's this concept that, you know, just because you're breathing in, you have this one kind of airflow going through this way, but there's also all these other kind of air currents that are going on at a very small level. And for something that's that small, it may very much be impacted by that. And so it's knocked off of that larger trajectory and ends up hitting the fiber and being neutralized as well. And then the final piece is electrostatic attraction, which is part of the N95 and some of our high quality surgical masks, where you actually have an electric charge here that helps to pull in the particle as well. So when we talk about testing, like for an N95, when we talk about being able to block 95%, it's not just of any sort of droplets. It's really this concept of the most penetrating particle size. So if you imagine, you know, the larger droplets are going to get impacted by this, the smaller droplets are going to get impacted by this. There may be this medium-sized group that's probably the best, quote unquote, at getting through those physical barriers. And that is the group that you want to make sure that you're reducing penetration, because if you can clear 95% of those and make sure that they're not getting through, then it makes you feel much better about all the other types of particles that would be around. I want to talk just a minute about what to look for if you're trying to see if these are certified or like kind of legitimate masks, especially in medical quality. So the ASTM is actually an international label. It was originated in the US, but it's an international group now. And so you can see this on various surgical masks, and they basically have a grading system. And so you want to look for, if you're buying a surgical mask, you want it to be ASTM level, and ideally level 3 is going to offer you your best protection. Level 2 will offer some protection and would generally avoid level 1 if, you know, you're looking for masks to purchase. When it comes to respirators or N95s, there's a few different varieties. So the first is the N95, which is what's actually produced in the US. A few things to look for there. You see this NIOSH is approved by, that's a national group that approves that. So unlike ASTM, this is a national group. They have a TC number on them, which means that they were individually tested. And all of them have these loops going around the back of the head. And those loops actually help to really enhance the fit and make sure you're sealing all the gaps. And we'll talk about fit more in a second. You also have the KN95. This is a similar product, only out of China. And the KN95 is, again, meant to meet those similar standards as far as the amount of particles it's filtering, but it has a little bit of difference, including these ear loops. And the KF94 is the similar product from Korea, again, certified by that government. It mimics this more. This is called a duckbill design, in the way it kind of folds flat and has parts that are both upper and above that kind of go and seal around the face. But it, again, is the Korean version of this version of the N95. So how to differentiate these two? The N95 is, in general, especially for us in the US, considered the highest standard, in part because we control that standardization. It's all approved through here, through NIOSH. And it also allows, it's a little bit easier to be able to ensure that it's not a fake because of the fact that it's produced locally within our country. This band is also going to enhance fit. So it's going to help to pull the mask and ensure that you have a good fit. There are benefits, though, to the KN95 and KF94 too. For one thing, there's a little bit more variability in options. There is ear loops on both, as we kind of mentioned, which may not help as much with the fit, but they certainly can be more comfortable for some people. And so that's important. And then this is probably the most important caveat, is that it's actually available in child sizes. So because these masks, first and foremost, are kind of produced for industry, there is no child version that is approved, whereas these do actually have child sizes and can be found. We talked a lot about fit, so we probably should get into that just a bit more. So fit is, of course, crucial for masks to be effective. So the first two, the two places you generally think about is around the bridge of the nose. That is why you see, you know, glasses fog up when you have a loose fitting mask, but also then around the cheeks as well. So how do you enhance fit? Well, the first thing you can do is a nose bridge. Can be very effective to limit upper area of release. And then another thing that you can do actually for a surgical mask is something called knotting and looping. And so the idea here is you create a knot and put it right there at the base of the mask. And then, you know, tuck in any excess material that's needed. And then you have a loop that you then would put around the ear. And so what that does is really helps to decrease the looseness here and enhance the fit. You also notice that these surgical masks have a nose bridge already built in, so it's going to help protect fit there as well. There's something else that you can do for a surgical mask. Both double masking and a mask brace are effective ways to also enhance the fit of the surgical mask. So the idea here, especially with the double masking, is that you put the surgical mask on bottom, so it's acting as your filter and kind of what's up against the skin. And then you use a cloth mask essentially for helping to compress and hold that surgical mask against the skin. The mask brace does the same thing. It's just kind of more designed for that purpose. You notice both of these pictures have someone with a beard. So these are a great way to augment your fit if you do have a beard. And they actually published a recent study in the American Journal of Infection Control looking at various measures and which ones were most effective. And these two were particularly effective and approached the level of some of the higher quality respirators when done. So function is, you know, kind of last thing we talk about, but certainly a very important aspect, because ultimately you have to have a mask that you can wear. And if you have a mask that you're going to be taking off frequently, that's not going to be very helpful. So first thing, you know, layering masks may seem appealing, especially if you have some cloth masks that you really like. Maybe you like a vibrant pattern or, you know, supporting your local sports team. You want to ensure that those are breathable and comfortable. So generally, if you have a single mask, especially like the respirators, surgical mask, et cetera, they have been kind of well tested to ensure comfortability when you're out doing exercise. But if you start layering masks and have various, especially with cloth, you don't have as much control or at least any standards around how thick that will be. Just important that you can breathe comfortably when you're doing that. The other thing is the vision may be obscured if it starts to ride up and try to cover your eyes. The other thing I'll note is there's actually several high quality options available right now. So you might consider trying a few styles that are available. There's actually some great newspaper reviews. I put a couple down there from the New York Times as well as the Boston Herald, just breaking down kind of various masks and reasons that people like one versus the other. This was published by the WHO and just recently, and I think a really helpful way to think about mask quality as well. Of course, most people aren't going to be wearing, I mean, although a PAPR is the most effective, you're not going to be wearing that into your local grocery store. But it's helpful, I think, specifically to focus in on these areas and the way they kind of give basically a layered approach. And so certainly your respirators are going to be kind of the highest quality mask that you would generally wear out in public, but there are some really good options to augment your surgical mask. Note that all of these are talking about an ASTM level 3 mask as your surgical mask, and using a mask brace or a layered fit with a cloth mask can be ways to augment that. The other thing is that fold and tuck kind of model that we talked about. The best examples of kind of your just general masking would be a well-fitted three-layer cloth mask. So one of those layers may be a filter pocket, and that would be great. And then having a nose wire or nose bridge to cover up that gap as well. And then ultimately an unmodified surgical ASTM 3 level mask would be reasonable as well. Things that you want to avoid is a lot of the things we talked about, not light blocking, valve mask, loose fit, adding in gaiters and bandanas because they are, you know, they are essentially not light blocking, not very thick and able to handle those respiratory secretions. So practically, how do you go about buying one? Well, Project N95 is a nonprofit that actually helps to go through and ensure that the products that they're listing and linking you to are official products. The New York Times also has some recent articles in January and February that walk through several, kind of has that input into the user's experience, but also has specific links. Some tips to spot a fake N95, well, it needs to have the NIOSH mark. If it doesn't, then it's not official. Again, we talked about that TC marking that demonstrates that it was individually tested. So if that's not there, then it's not a real mask, or not a official mask, I suppose. None of them will have ear loops. They all have bands going across the back. And so if it has ear loops, then it's not a certified N95. And then again, they don't make them for children. So an N95 for children does not exist. This is just an example of how tricky some of these companies are, right? So that looks at just initial glance like it's got the NIOSH mark, but they have modified it for you. So what about a KN95 or KF94? Remember that those are the groups from China and Korea. And so for them, they usually have branding because they want to sell their product, right? So if you get something and it doesn't have branding on it, then you should be concerned that it may not be an official mask. Generally, they're going to be packaged in something that's tamper evident. So if it's just loosely packaged or not well packaged, you should be concerned. They caught on to the NIOSH thing. And so some will actually say NIOSH approved. If that's the case, then that's not an official mask from those countries because those countries don't go through NIOSH. They have their own system of accreditation. And then there's no uniform markings on the KF94, but the KN95 does have this uniform marking, kind of like the TC that should be on all of them. It references some code or law that was in China. Most will say 2019. Some older ones may say 2006 with the same lead-in code. If you see that, just make sure that it's, you know, not past its expiration date. But those are some tips you might look at for spotting a fake. The other thing to ask is, you know, the government has released several free distribution sites, and so or several masks to be free and available to the public. And so the Alabama.com put a nice article out about where to call and try to see if your local group has them. And so I've just listed some of the stores there. There's several other pharmacies and other groups that are involved. Just didn't have room on the slide for all, but you can go to that article and find out more. The kind of other question that comes up is reusable respirators. So how often can I reuse one, et cetera? So in healthcare settings, we actually were reusing N95s up to 5 times. So you would, if you were on a unit that had COVID patients, you would get one for the day. And then it had a very formal process of being reprocessed and then labeled for you to pick up a few days later and then use again. And you could do it up to 5 times. That was something we were doing during a time of crisis capacity. We're not there anymore, thankfully. And so we're not reusing them in that setting. But for the public, reuse is certainly very reasonable. In fact, Dr. Tsai, who actually created the medical N95 and is actually based out of Tennessee, the University of Tennessee, did a nice article talking about his approach to this. And he really has just a kind of a rotation and will store them and hang them in between. And one option is to use a brown paper bag because that's particularly good at basically drying out respiratory particles. And so having a rotation every few days where you can pull out a new one that's been sitting for a while and therefore hopefully partially decontaminated. The thing to note though is although the filter really should continue to be effective in general, if it's become soiled, then it's not going to be. So if you notice any soiling, then certainly you should change out that mask, and the mask over time is going to start stretching and not having as good a fit. So if the fit is being affected, certainly it's time to get a new one. So this kind of moves into the section where we talk a little bit about the data that's out there. And I just highlight a few studies that I thought were important and relevant. And so the first question that you have to ask is, are masks effective for the wearer? And so this was just recently published study out of California and MMWR. And what they did is a neat study design. They had about 600 people that tested positive for SARS-CoV-2 during this time frame, February 10th to December 1st. And then they matched them with two controls that tested negative during the same time frame. And the matching was just based off the rates of spread in the community, like the isolated community that person was tested in at the time. And so they called them and they asked them several questions. They asked about like vaccination status and SES factors and other things that they could adjust for, but they specifically asked them about masking and what was their habit as far as masking in indoor public settings. And what they saw first and foremost is that any mask, if you just lump these all as a group, people that said that they wore any mask consistently had less infection than those who were less likely to test positive than those who wore no mask. If you start to break it out, you actually lose the significance in the cloth mask group, but you maintain significance in both the surgical mask group and respirator group as well. And there appeared to be a bit of a gradated pattern where, you know, each level offered enhanced protection. Although I will say that these two had overlapping confidence intervals, and thus there was not a statistical significance between the group that wore a surgical mask and the group that wore a respirator. So my take, I guess, as a clinician and counseling my patients is this is just a really reaffirming study that in the real world, it seems like going about, making a choice to mask and even potentially the type of mask that you're choosing may help to add extra protection for you when you find yourself out in the world in public spaces. So it's a positive study about the effects masks have for the wearer. The second is, are masks effective at source control? There's actually been a lot of studies that have looked at that over time. I mean, the baseline question is, do they filter particles that you're breathing? And that is, it seems very true. And so looking at both cloth mask and surgical mask, if you put one on a patient or a person, you'll see less respiratory droplets in general that they release. On top of that, the question is, well, do they actually decrease the amount of detected virus? And so there was a study that looked at seasonal coronavirus, so not COVID-19, but seasonal coronavirus. And they looked at whether or not that there was a decrease, and they found a significant decrease in both droplets and aerosols admitted from patients who were infected with the seasonal coronavirus. They also looked at the same for influenza and saw a decrease in it that was detected in droplets. Surgical mask. Then again, another study decreased the amount of exhaled influenza virus in general by 3.4 fold. And finally, a more recent study looking at SARS-CoV-2 showed that surgical masks decreased the amount of SARS-CoV-2 RNA by about 45% in smaller particles, those less than 5 micrometers, and 77% in those larger particles. So again, multiple studies all looking at cloth and surgical masks, showing them to be actually quite effective at source control, or at least limiting the amount that's emitted. And perhaps the best anecdote that was published in MMWR early on in the pandemic was the story of the two hairdressers out in California. And so that was in a hair salon where they did universal masking, and two hairdressers were actually symptomatic for a period. They had 139 clients come through. You think about that, it's, you know, close contact, long period of time, it would think about a high risk exposure event, and none of those 139 clients tested positive. And it was all thought to be a great anecdote to emphasize the importance of source control. And of course, at that time, early in the pandemic, you would expect the type of mask they were wearing was actually probably a cloth mask, although I don't think it was reported in the actual report. So the next question comes, well, what about universal masking policies? And I think this we're sharing in part because it's our data. It's local here. I mean, we did the study here at UAB. And so if you can imagine, I know it's hard to being back in March of 2020. And, you know, most people, there was no real precedence for masking in at least our community. There were other places internationally. And so as we started to see infections in the hospital, there were some people who were starting to mask based off what they read other places. But most people were only masking in times where it was, you know, mentioned at the door too. So that was our kind of pre-intervention period when we started to see cases, but there was no universal masking requirement in our facility. And then we did a universal masking requirement. So everyone was, all the providers were masked, patients were encouraged to mask when able. And so that was our second period of a couple weeks. And then on top of that, we augmented it with testing. And so we added in, not only is everyone masking, but we're having testing of our patients as they're coming into the hospital. And so what we saw was that, and I guess another caveat to make is, of course, things have changed over time. So at the time, the criteria for testing, for symptomatic testing was actually pretty strict and not the entire spectrum of disease that we know of today. But the other piece was that the definition of a high-risk exposure was quite different. So essentially, if both the source and the healthcare worker if either of the source or the healthcare worker was wearing a mask, it would not be considered a high-risk exposure. So both had to not be wearing a mask to be a high-risk exposure. And what we saw is just even at that level, universal masking had quite a profound effect, 73% reduction in rates of high-risk exposures that were reported by our healthcare workers. And so we were looking at, did a healthcare worker have an exposure that they reported to our system so that we could track them and do testing as appropriate? And so we saw a 73% reduction in that when we just went to universal masking. And then when we added on universal testing of all our patients, we saw a traumatic response even on top of that. So an additional 86% reduction. So it just speaks to, again, when we showed that picture about the importance of the layers, I think this study just speaks to that. Universal masking certainly was beneficial in and of itself, but it's also beneficial to add other steps onto that. This category down here is aerosolizing procedures. A surgical mask is not sufficient PPE for aerosolizing procedures. So we don't see the same profound effect in just the universal masking period. But of course, when you start testing, you did see a benefit. And again, this also speaks into how we've kind of used testing and even evolved to use testing in the community to an extent when someone is going into a higher risk situation, like a family function with someone who's immune suppressed, and encouraging testing for that group before the encounter, as well as masking, and the importance of those kind of two gradations of steps. So how does universal masking shake out in the community? And so there's this great community level intervention from Bangladesh that was recently reported in Science. It's really a terrific read. But what they did was they looked at these small communities in that region and ended up encompassing about 340,000 adults. And so they took a proportion of those areas and they did some basically community level interventions. So they were giving out free masks, they were doing education around masking, and they were encouraging their leaders to mask. And the first thing from a public health perspective is to say just like, wow, they actually saw a benefit when doing that. And so how was this measured? How was mask use measured? Well, they actually had people out in the community in public spaces, keeping track and kind of keeping tallies of the percentages of people that they saw masking. And what you see is a pretty significant benefit with their public health interventions. But the next question is, well, Was it effective in preventing transmission in that community? And so the way they tested that was they had surveys asking about COVID symptoms. And then if you did have a COVID symptoms, they try to do serologic testing. So looking for antibodies to see if you had evidence of a recent COVID infection. And so again, I mean, wonderful that we had an improvement. Note that it was still only about a 42% masking. So it was not above 50% even of the amount of people that were masking in these communities. But with that moderate improvement, we saw a significant reduction both in COVID symptoms reported, and then for those that they were able to actually get the blood samples for and do seropositivity, a reduction there too. So I think what this, you know, kind of says to me as a provider is, A, it's wonderful to know that our public health interventions can certainly have an effect. And B, it's helpful to see that even with a moderate effect, you can start to see reductions in infections across your community. So, of course, the big community level discussion that happened right at, you know, the summer of last year was all around masking in schools and the importance of universal masking or not. And there was a huge, as you know, debate around that all over the country. And so what I think is wonderful is that we actually have a couple of studies recently published that actually tried to look at those interventions and give us a better understanding of how they helped or how they didn't. So the first was published, again, in MMWR. And what they did here was they basically looked across the country and they looked at all the counties that either had uniformity. So they either had to all be masking or none be masking, all of the different school districts. And if there was any heterogeneity, they were excluded. So they were able to get it down to 520 counties that had uniformity, and you'll see about 40% of those had the mask requirement and the rest did not. And so then what they wanted to ask is, of course, schools don't all start at the same week. And so they wanted to really compare week to week. So they wanted to see, you know, for those that had the mask requirements, did they have less of a jump as school started compared to those who didn't? And what they found was that there actually was a statistically significant difference. So those schools, the darker ones here that were in counties where there was not a school mask requirement, they saw a larger jump in cases in children and adolescents after school started, depending on the kind of week grouping that you're looking at here, compared to those counties that did have a school mask requirement, there was less of an increase after school started, which is, of course, going to be a higher risk time frame given the amount of time spent with various people in closer contact. The other study that was published in MMWR recently that looked at the same question a little bit differently, same time period, beginning of school 2021, was done out in Arizona. And it was pretty neat. They actually looked at individual schools. And so they looked at whether or not the school itself had a mask requirement or universal masking or not. And then they looked at whether or not an outbreak happened in those first few weeks. And so an outbreak was defined as multiple infections over the course of a week. And what they saw is that those schools that did have a mask requirement or had less outbreaks, I guess a better way to say it is those without the mask requirement, we're 3.5 times more likely to have an outbreak. And so again, another thing that just emphasized the importance of that intervention that we were discussing at that time. Now, I decided to share this study because I know it's coming up more and more and various people talking about this topic. And I hesitated a bit just because I knew that there might be people here listening that don't have a background in interpreting scientific literature. But I think it's important that we acknowledge that, you know, whenever you ask a question, you can ask it many different ways. And sometimes you're going to see studies that are positive, and other times you're going to see studies that don't meet that factor. And so this is actually the kind of study that they point to that did not meet the endpoint for protection. And so, first off, I guess whenever you're looking at this as a provider, the question I'm asking, well, does this apply, you know, to my patients? And if so, how? And really, how did they design the study? Because it was published in a good journal that is peer reviewed. And so the question they were asking here, or what they, I guess, essentially did is they went to Denmark, which does not actually do masking much in their community. So the average masking rate is around 5%. And then they wanted to test, like, what they were looking for was a 50% reduction in infections if they did masking. So they powered their study for that. And what that means is that they predicted that if they did a study with 6,000 adults, that they would be able to determine if there was a 50% reduction or not. So they weren't looking for any reduction. They were just looking for that specific number of 50%. So they recruited 6,000 individuals, and half of them, they didn't, you know, do anything with masking. And the other half, they basically gave them a supply of surgical masks and instructed them to wear the surgical mask when outside the home. And they followed that for a month. And then they looked on the back end to see if they were positive based off PCR testing and antibody test. And what they found was what we look for is we look at this odds ratio. And so odds ratio less than one indicates protection. So it would indicate that masks were protective or the masking group was protective. But then we want the confidence interval, and we want that to be either less. We want it in this case to be all less than one. And that would indicate that it was statistically significant, the result that we found. This fact that it crosses one makes us worry that potentially there is a chance that we missed the mark or the result. How you make this interval, you notice it's pretty wide. So how you make this interval smaller is actually recruit more individuals theoretically. And so what would likely happen if you recruited more individuals and did it on a larger scale is this might start to narrow and would very likely end up being a positive study. It just wouldn't be for the 50% reduction that they powered the study for. So what does this mean? I guess for me, I mean, I think it's important to think, what is the question they were asking? So this is a place where really no one is masking, or very few is masking. So they're not asking about community masking and all the benefits that come in with source control and other things. They're really asking, if you are as an isolated individual going out in the world with a mask, is that beneficial? And the way they asked that was using surgical masks, which they didn't really clarify what ASTM rating it was, at least in the, it may be in some of the other components, but they didn't talk about the ASTM level or any sort of modifications for fit that they did. And so you would assume that they didn't do those. And so we kind of talked about when we layered out our mask that just a surgical mask is kind of the lower bar, and that there are a lot of things you can do to enhance fit with the surgical mask, as well as to wear an N95 respirator. And so I think when I look at this study, I guess what I, the way I would interpret it for my patients, because they have this question, you know, I am taking care of patients who are immune compromised. Many of them are, you know, at a point where they've been through this for the last 2 years. They're really wanting to get out and just do some very basic things, like go shopping on a weekend day, go back to church, do things that are really important for them. And they want to know like how they can protect themselves. And so I think that this study is actually less helpful for me in answering that because, you know, of the not really clarifying the way that they were using the surgical mask, A, and B, the fact that there was just such a low rate of masking in the community in general. And when they even asked the participants who were in the control arm for masking, whether or not they masked, there was a portion, 7%, that didn't mask at all. And then there was about half of the rest that said they masked predominantly, which is kind of not really clear as to how much they are adhering to those measures. So I think to me, this California study is a much better example because it's really looking at your personal behavior, your choice. You decided to use these various quality of masks. You've like done the research to make sure you're using them effectively. And you honestly are probably also doing some additional interventions, like thinking about social distancing, time in a space, et cetera. And what we saw when we looked at this population was that you could, you know, have some benefit with both the respirator and the surgical mask. So I think this, it, to me, is a really reassuring thing that I can counsel my patients when they're looking at me and saying, you know, we really want to start doing some of these things to just empower them with the knowledge of how these masks can help them as an individual. So to the question of, are masks effective? I think clearly they reduce aerosols and droplets emitted. That can be done at kind of a physical science level. We've seen that they reduce transmission from those infected or provide source control. It reduces the risk of infection for those who are wearing them. We certainly know that in a healthcare setting, but we even have some evidence of that in the community setting. And then there are several community studies that have showed that if you increase masking in the community, you also have lower infection rates, which is, I think, a really important point. So how do we move forward from this? I think the first is that it is an important individual tool to decrease your risk of infection. As we talked about, really fit is crucial, and consider a respirator, especially in a higher risk scenario. The other thing to note is that individual masking can help with reducing spread of respiratory pathogens in general. And so I chose respiratory pathogens in general because I think it's worth considering as we move forward and you have seasonal flu, just other seasonal viruses that people get, may be helpful to like make masking more normal in those situations as a way to reduce spread. And then finally, community masking efforts are helpful to mitigate spread when rates are high in the community. And we've seen that through various studies at various points when the rates were high. Some conclusions to note is just, again, that these respiratory viruses, we've learned now how they spread through various circulations of various size. And so it's important to take that into consideration when you think about the whole debate that happened around aerosol versus droplet. Preventive studies work best in combination. I think that's true kind of across the board. What to think about practically when you're considering a mask. And masks are helpful tools for us, both as individuals, but certainly also as a community level. I want to acknowledge several people, but in particular, Dr. Lee, who was pictured actually earlier on in the preliminary slides, but also has just been a great mentor for me in infection prevention.
I think we are at the end of our time, but we just want to thank you again for being here today and sharing this information with us. And thank you for watching, everyone. Have a good day.